James Carr, one of the most notorious rebels in the California prison system, had been on the streets just 3.5 months when he was gunned down outside his San Jose home in April 1972. Before he died, Jimmy recorded over 24 hours of tape which formed the basis of Bad, the autobiography of James Carr, which has just been published by Dell. You are about to hear a few of the stories from these tapes, beginning when Jimmy was a 16-year-old con at San Quentin, moving with Jimmy and George Jackson to the riot on D Wing at Soledad, and then back to the end of the world, San Quentin.
When I get to the hole, all these Muslims are in the hole. So when I come up, they put me in a cell, right? And I'm sitting there, and I don't know anybody, and I'm just laying there. And I hear these dudes talking about Allah, and I never even heard this word. I'm trying to think, what the fuck these guys are talking about? All these theories and shit that they have, you know, about how white people were created and black people supposed to have two genes and all this whole trip, you know, okay? And I'm listening to this shit and I don't know what it is. I didn't know what a gene was. And dude, Lamar Rivers, who is the protagonist of all this shit because he's got the biggest mouth, and then he knows this ideology, this pseudo-ideology of the black, of the black Muslims better than anyone else. And so he just runs this shit all into the wee hours of the night, you know, in the early morning, and he's still going, you know. And he, to describe him, he was like about, he looked like the guy on Hill's Brothers Coffee, right? That's my best description ever. I always said that. The guy on Hill's Brothers Coffee is about 5'6", right? About 6'6", and just skinny as can be, because he fasts all the time. And, he talks like one of those mumbo jumbles, you know, like he knows the truth, you know. Mm-hmm. It's everything he says is prophetic, you know. Mm-hmm. It's a gift of prophecy. And the dude is just really too fucking much. So anyway, he calls over to my cell and he says, "Hey, but if I'd have listened to him, I would have been rich." Uh-huh. That's one thing I always look back at that dude. He calls over and he starts talking to me, so I tell him, he says, "Where you come from?" And I tell him, he says, "It's unconstitutional for you to be here." He says, "And if you file writ when you get out of here about it and sue them, you can sue them for putting you here because you're not supposed to put juvenile commitments in prisons, right?" And I just kind of listen to him. I don't want to hear that shit, you know, it didn't mean nothing to me. Yeah. And so then he tells me, he says, "You ever heard of the word of the messenger?" And I says, "What messenger are you talking about?" He's talking about Elijah Muhammad. And I told him, "Nope." And he tells me, he says, "You eat pork?" And I told him, "Yeah." He says, "You shouldn't eat pork." He tells me that it stagnates your brain and all this stuff, and it kills you, and it has worms. And he just takes me on this big trip, and he starts trying to convert me. So they give pork every day there. That's all they give up there in the hole is pork. Pork and cheese sandwiches. And the Muslims have been fasting ever since they've been up there. After 15 days, they still hadn't eaten, right? And they're really hungry. And all of them refuse to eat unless they bring them some food that they can eat. It corresponds with their religion, all right? In the meantime, I'm eating graciously because they're fasting and I'm taking all the food. So Nelson at the time was associate superintendent. He wasn't a warden like he is now. Yeah. Right? And they called him Red Nelson because he's a fool. Yeah. Red hair, red neck, motherfucker. You understand? So he had given an order that nothing would be served there but pork and mush, right? And even the salad had pork cut up in it. That's no bullshit, that's the truth.
That was obviously the deal.
Right, he wanted them to eat pork. So there was one guy that hadn't been in the Muslims very long and he just got hungry, man. The guy was really hungry. And he just asked the cop, he says, "Look, I'm starving to death, I want some fucking food, man." He said, "I can't take this no more, I gotta come off this." So the cop goes and calls Red Nelson. Red Nelson comes up to the hole personally. At the time, the hole was up on death row. One side was death row and the other side was the hole. And you could talk to the guys in death row through the ventilator, right? So Nelson comes up that afternoon And he tells him, he says, "Are you hungry?" And he says, "Yeah, I'm hungry." They had some pig feet and some ham hocks and beans that they had boiled up. They took him out front, told him, "Come on out the cell." Took him out front, gave him a fork and a plate, told him, "Dig in." And he sat there and he ate the pig feet and the hogs and shit, and came back. And when he came back, they let him eat around the corner, right?
Oh, I see.
They bring him back, and so Nelson tells him, he says, and he got all these cops with him, shotguns and shit. Tells him, "Tell him what you had to eat, boy." And the dude is really ashamed, you know, that he got what he can eat. And Nelson says, "Tell him what you had to eat." And so LeBron Rivers said, "What did you have to eat?" he says, "I had some pork." He says, "Tell him what it was." And he tells him, says, "Some pig feet, some ham hocks, and some beans." And Nelson tells him, "So now get it in your cell." He says, "Now any of the rest of y'all want to eat, there's plenty left." He's a dog, motherfucker. Well, he's really a dog. And so I'm just sitting there, and I'm looking at this motherfucker. I'm saying, "Boy, this is about a dog, motherfucker." Yeah, boy.
That's the first time.
And he just, and he just grinning, you know. And so he leaves, and Lamar just starts preaching, you know. "Ah, the motherfucker, Allah can get him and run him off the planet." So they take Lamar to the disciplinary committee, and Nelson's sitting in there. And Lamar's a fanatic. He's like this, you know, real tense, hypertensive. And he tells him, he says, "Beast, you're the beast." And he jumps up on the table and kicks Nelson in the mouth, and the police are dragging him out of Nelson's office, and he's kicking and hollering and shit, you know. Madman. So they take him and they send him to Vacaville and give him shock treatment till he forgot all about Allah. Booker was this guy that had the leadership ability, right? He could sway a lot of people in his direction. And he was converting I guess every month he might convert maybe 10, 15.
He's a Muslim.
He's a Muslim, right. He would convert at least maybe 10 to 15 dudes to Islam, right? And blacks were coming in a lot. Matter of fact, quite a few blacks were coming to San Quentin at this time, right around 61, huh? So he was constantly being harassed. They were constantly tearing his cell up, constantly catching him on the yard, shaking him down, fucking with him and everything else, and threatening him, threatening his life. But he continues to preach this stuff, right? So finally they put him and Lamar Rivers and a whole lot of other Muslims over in the in the adjustment center. And after they get him in the adjustment center, he continues to preach this stuff, right? And every day they go out on the yard, they have their little meetings over in the corner, the Muslims. And there was quite a few Nazis also in there. But there was no conflict between the Nazis and Muslims. They just like, both of them seemed to believe in the same thing in a way, you know what I mean? One believed in white supremacy, the other one believed in black supremacy. And one found a justification in his belief and that the other one believed the way that he did. And so they kind of more or less got along pretty well, you know. They didn't associate, but it was understood that they didn't like one another and they just stayed away from each other. Anyway, Captain Hawker wasn't satisfied with that, him and Red Nelson. And they wanted to get rid of Booker because Booker was causing him a lot of problems. So they up and call couple of these Nazis out and tell them, says, "Look, man, reason we know this is true because the Nazis told it later on, right?" Says, "Look," says, we want to get rid of this dude Booker. Says, "And if you guys go out and start a fight with the Muslims on the yard, adjustments in the yard, says, we're going to reach down and shoot them." And all around the adjustments in the yard are these tall buildings. And the guards like can hide up there with rifles and shit if they want to, right? So the Nazis go for this thing, right? And they start a fight with the Muslims and they get the fighting out there. And then as soon as they start fighting, they start backing up, right? And as soon as they do this, they shot this dude Booker right in the head and murdered him. It's just another example of how they actually sit around there murdering people at will. Whenever they want to kill somebody, they just kill them. It's just that simple. And they just need a very little excuse to do it. And most of the time when they function, that's the way it is. They want an excuse for moving. They won't just come and just shoot you. They'll sit it up and then they'll murder you. Anyway, they murdered this dude, Booker, and I just wanted to get that on the tape.